should we worship Jesus as being God? So my points of the day might be these. I think number one, the question is, does the object of our worship matter? In other words, as long as you are worshiping, does God really care if you're confused about who he is or who Jesus is and questions like that? But the second point is, I'm going to allege that confusion about the object or the person of our worship results in confused faith and confused worship. I don't think you have confusion about the object of our worship without having a confused faith and confused worship. That doesn't seem good. That doesn't seem right. And my third point is, and God is not the friend of confusion. He is the great God. He wants people to know him and worship him rightly. Those are my assertions. Confusion versus clarity. I think that's what's at stake. And then confusion in faith, confusion in worship. And is that really the way we want to approach God, God Almighty? I think that's not what the way he wants us to approach him. I don't think God is happy when we're working in confusion in any aspect of our faith or in any aspect of our worship. I thought I'd give you an example of confused worship, and you can tell me if you think it makes a difference. Okay. Here is some worship that I think shouldn't be because we've got this person misunderstood, and that is Mary, the mother of Jesus. There is this thought, a pervasive thought, that she is to be venerated. Not just honored or respected, but she's to be venerated, raised up, lifted on high, above normal mortals and all that. And I might mention, if you're going to venerate her right now, this dear woman is dead anyway. So I don't know how you're going to venerate her. But they assume she's still alive, so we're going to work with from their perspective. But they're also saying she is the, and I quote, mother of God. Okay. Does it matter if you think Mary is the mother of God? I think you're confused about who you're supposed to be worshiping, and you're confused about the object of your worship. And is God pleased with this confusion? Because if it doesn't matter about the object of our worship, then I guess worshiping Mary as the mother of God is okay, I suppose. Because you're worshiping honestly, sincerely, but is that pleasing to God? And by the way, this Mother of God title view has gone so far that there literally are people who feel like she should genuinely be considered the fourth member of the Trinity. I don't know, you'd have to rename it Quadrinity or something at that point. But anyway, that is sincerely true. Now, she is prayed to daily by millions of people throughout the world. And as it turns out, she's thought to be our primary intercessor with God in the view of so many. Okay. Now, we're talking about the object of our worship and who we're worshiping. Okay. And if the object of our worship doesn't matter, then I don't think we should worry about trying to help people to stop venerating Mary in what we think would be inappropriate ways, because the object of your worship doesn't matter. And the understanding of that doesn't matter, but it does. I think all of us, particularly who are Protestants, we sense that, and we have no difficulty saying, oh, this doesn't work well. So confusion, this is confusion. It's confusing our faith, and in the process, we're robbing God of attention that's supposed to be going to him and prayers that are his. And by the way, I think we're also robbing Jesus of his place, his station, his honor as being our true intercessor. 1 Timothy 2:5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. I love that. Wow, everybody should know that one. Everybody, teach your children to recite that from the time they're about 4 years old or so. So I think it tells the whole story about God, Jesus, intercession. But if we're going to really look to Mary and think of her as our intercessor, then aren't we robbing Jesus of the honor that's due for his being truly our intercessor? There's one God and one mediator. Okay. So I think it does matter. It's important who we worship. It's important how we worship and what we think as we're worshiping. And we do wind up robbing God if we worship unwisely or in confusion. And we wind up robbing Jesus of what's appropriately his. So let's think about it for a minute. There are two, these are the two central characters of the Bible, God and Christ. God, who created us and all of creation, and then Christ, who is our Redeemer and redeems creation. Jesus was not the creator in the Genesis creation. His role in creation is to redeem the creation, but which has fallen. And that's the beginnings, that's the understanding we come to in the new creation. That's where Jesus begins to creating, not back in Genesis. That's just confusion. So, and if we're, by the way, if we're going to worship Jesus as being the Genesis creator, it's confusion. It confuses our faith, and it confuses our worship. Because now we're worshiping Jesus for something that God did. It gets very, very strange. So anyway, the Bible begins with God himself. Genesis 1 and 1. In the beginning, God. Okay. And then it ends with God and the Messiah, the Christ. Revelation 22. So literally, we start out with God. Not with God and Christ in the beginning, as some might think. But it start out with God himself in the beginning, and then we end with God and the Messiah at the end of this wonderful book. But here's the deal. If we confuse these main characters, then it confuses our faith, and it is, I'm saying it's confusing our life relationship with God. So this isn't theoretical. This comes down to my daily walk with God. This comes down to when I get up in the mornings and I'm thinking about God, I'm thinking about Christ, I'm thinking about these things, then at that point, my life is being affected by my misunderstandings, my misappropriations, my confusion. So understanding properly, getting a handle on these things rightly, is important to our faith, to our lives. It's not just a hypothetical thing or something to discuss when we've got nothing better to talk about. This is crucial, I think. That's my thought. Okay. If you confuse the main characters, I think you can miss the whole point. And here's an example. I've used this before, but it just occurred to me. But if you read Herman Melville's classic book, Moby Dick, a very popular book from way back, and it's an amazing story. It's a wonderful venture, if you will. But the story is being told by someone named Ishmael, who is a sailor on a boat. And he records the adventure of Captain Ahab. And Captain Ahab's quest to kill Moby Dick, who is a great whale, in revenge, I guess for the fact that on a previous trip, the whale had actually taken off, unfortunately, Captain Ahab's leg, or part of one of his legs. So he's out to get this whale. That's the idea. That's Moby Dick. That's the story behind it. So, but what if you get these characters confused? These are main characters in the book, so it's very important to understand. What if you thought Moby Dick is the captain of a ship, and you thought Ahab is a whale? So then what you really have then is you have Moby Dick, who is living his life on a ship, okay, and that's a whale living on a ship. Or you have also then Ahab, a captain, a man, who's living endlessly in the water. It's all hopelessly confusing, isn't it? So getting the characters right is crucial, and it's crucial to our understanding of the Bible, and it's crucial to our faith, and it's very crucial then to our worship. Getting these things right, understanding them correctly. So let's hear from God himself. I think he's the one who lays this out. We need to trust what God says, what Jesus says. What do they think? That's the key, I think, to all of this. So God, that is Yahweh, is God, and there is no other. And I'm going to say this. God does not accept confusion in our worship. He may abide it. He may let us paddle along with it. But that's not what he accepts. He doesn't like that at all. That means someone who's wanting to worship him is in utter confusion, and their worship may be even in vain at times. What do you think? The dear people out there who are worshiping in one form or another, Mary? God says, though, in Deuteronomy 6:15, because the Lord your God who is present with you is a jealous God. I just wanted to pick this up. He's a jealous God. What is he saying? He doesn't like sharing himself as God with others that we would think are God, who take his role or his place in some way in our hearts or in our minds. The Lord, Yahweh, your God, he's present with you. He's a jealous God. So don't be fiddling around with others and calling them God. Don't be going down that avenue. God will not be pleased. And say, well, God doesn't care. He's a God of mercy and all that. Well, okay, if you say so. I know he is, but how? At what point does God say, that's enough of this? You're just flat out wrong. You're giving my glory to someone else. You're honoring others with the honor that belongs only to me. You're saying somebody else is the creator of the universe or the earth. That's not right. Remember, we said whoever did the work is the one who rested on that seventh day in Genesis. So who rested? It was God himself. So I love that again. God does not accept confusion in our worship. May he forgive us? I don't know. That's up to him. But ignorance in our worship is very unacceptable. I'll put it that way. So that's, again, I noticed in 1 Corinthians 14 where Paul says God is not the author of confusion. God is not the friend of confusion. We'll put it that way. Okay. Now, I do ask this question, and I don't know the answer. Is it not idol worship to worship anyone or anything as being God Almighty other than this one who says he's a jealous God? Don't be worshiping anybody else as God but me. What do you think? So I think, okay, if you wanted to have a problem, again, it's not so much a question of whether we worship Jesus. We're going to talk about that in a moment. The question is, are you worshiping him appropriately for who he really is? But if you're worshiping him as being God Almighty, you have missed it. And then the question becomes, aren't you then making an idol, an inappropriate object of worship out of Jesus, the Son of God, and treating him as though he was God himself? That's just not right. Wow, at least that's what we're saying. And I think that's what the scriptures say as well. So, could it be idol worship? That's not something for us to ask. I think to answer, that's not a question for us to answer. It's a question for our friends to answer who want to make, in their theology, make Jesus God Almighty. Don't you have a problem then? Okay. That's what I think. Okay. He alone then, God alone, is to be worshipped as God Almighty, our Creator. And he does not share the glory of being God with anyone. Neither do I believe that he shares the glory of being the creator of mankind with anyone. Not really. We want to split it up. We want to say, oh, well, he had a couple other that were working with him and so on. So it wasn't just him. But actually, I don't think he buys that. That's confusion. Now, we know that Jesus is involved. He is the means, the instrument through which God is making a new creation, but not the first creation. Isaiah 42:8, the Lord says this, that is Yahweh. I am Yahweh, that is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. But actually, he doesn't give his praise to human beings. He doesn't give his praise to anybody. Not that of being God. Wow. And he certainly doesn't want to give it to idols. He's not going to give it to idols. And he's not going to accept us giving it to idols or us giving his glory to anybody. Even his own son, that's confusion. Okay. So giving anyone or anything the glory that is his alone is, I'm saying, a huge, unacceptable error. And I ask this question again, will he forgive people who are in ignorance in this matter? That's not really mine to say. That's not my, you know, it's above my pay grade, as they would say. That's not mine. I don't know if he will or not, or what it will be, but I do know this. Once I've known the truth about these things, if I refuse those things and continue to worship someone else as though they're God Almighty, then I think I'm not going to be too, you know, God's not going to be pleased with me at all. I really can't even claim ignorance very well at that point. In the day of judgment, I'm going to stand there, and he's going to be saying, you should have known better. Why did you do this? Okay. So now let's advance to this thought. He, that is God, does give a glory. He doesn't give his glory, the glory of being God, the glory of being Yahweh. He doesn't give that to anybody else. But he does give a glory to his appointed kings, his rulers. But it is the glory of being his king, never the glory of actually being God himself. How confusing would that be? So I like this example in 1 Chronicles 29 and verse 23. And you can read more in the 29th chapter, 1 Chronicles, on this. But then Solomon sat on the throne of the Lord, succeeding his father David as king. He prospered, and all Israel obeyed him. And all the princes and the mighty men and all the sons likewise of King David submitted themselves to Solomon the king. So isn't this interesting? Solomon actually sat on the throne of Yahweh, not in heaven or whatever. He's sitting on the throne that God has given him, and the ownership of the throne, control of that throne, and who sits on it, that depends on God himself. That's his throne. That's what we're saying here. Solomon sat on, not on Solomon's throne, not really. He sat on the throne of the Lord, the throne that the Lord gave him, and the same throne that David had sat upon. He prospered. All Israel obeyed him. I guess that made God mad, because everybody's obeying this Solomon guy. No, not at all. God was very pleased that they were obeying him. That was God's plan. And all the princes and the mighty men and all the sons likewise of King David submitted themselves to Solomon the king. That had to make God very angry. No, it didn't. Say, well, only God is God. Well, that's right. If they were bowing to Solomon as though he were God, that would be a horrific error, horrific confusion, and God would have held him accountable. Wow, okay. So God gave Solomon glory. Jesus spoke in Luke 12 and 27. It's very beautiful. Remember, he says, Solomon in all of his glory, talking about the lilies of the field. Solomon in all of his glory. Well, Solomon had great glory, but still not as great as the lilies of the field, according to Jesus. But Solomon had all this glory, but he had glory by God's choice. And he didn't have the glory of being God, for goodness sakes. And neither was he competition to God. God's anointed, appointed kings and rulers, when they're right, they're not in competition with God. Actually, they are bringing even more glory to God as they accomplish their role under God. So Solomon sat on the throne of God. The people all gave him great glory. All of Israel obeyed Solomon. They all called him Lord. They bowed before him and even were prostrate before him at times, laying themselves totally out on the floor, on the ground before him. So that's great, great, great glory and great honor. That's what God allows and gives to one who is his appointed king. I think it's beautiful. I love this. But wouldn't it have been awful if somebody said, well, you know, Solomon, everybody's bowing to him. That means Solomon is God. Well, no, not at all. That's not what it means at all. It means God Almighty has given him great station, place, glory, and honor. And God Almighty is backing it up, because You couldn't have in that day said, well, this Solomon guy, I just serve God. I don't want anything to do with this Solomon fellow. Well, you can't serve God in that moment, in that day, without being subject to and obeying Solomon, because God is the one who placed him there over the people. Okay. So it is in this way, then, that Jesus has been given a glory. Okay. As the glory of, I'm saying, the King, the Christ. Okay. Not the glory of being God. That, again, is utter confusion. But the glory of being God's true human Son. Okay. Being God's Messiah, the Christ, God's King, that God established. So in John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, and the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The Word, which everybody argues about and so on, I will not, it's not our purpose to talk about that at the moment, but for your purposes at the moment, I will say this. We're not talking about Word like another person came and got inside this person or this flesh. Not so. The eternal Word of God, God's own personal Word, not a person called the Word, but God's own personal Word, worked and became flesh and dwelled among, tented among us in the person of God's Son, Jesus Christ. So, and we've seen his glory now because God dwelled in him by his Word and through this glory and all these wonderful things. Now we've seen this glory, the glory of the Father's Son. So Jesus doesn't have the glory of God or being God, but he has the glory of being God's Son, God's true human Son, God begotten Son. Okay. So the glory that Jesus has, and that for which he is worthy of honor, God gave him the glory, by the way, it's not innate. It's not just what he was or how he was. It was given to him. Acts 2:36, very important scripture. Right after everybody gets down 1 Timothy 2:5, for there is one God and one mediator between God and men, Christ Jesus, the man, Christ Jesus. Then we need to get Acts 2:36 down for your four-year-old child. Okay, so Acts 2:36, God has made this same Jesus that you crucified Lord and Christ. Wow. So, I love this. God has made him these things. So, he wasn't that. He wasn't already Lord and Christ somewhere in heaven or something. God made him that. And when and how did God make him that? God made him those things after he pleased God by giving himself for us, his fellow man. So, when the people gave those kings, David, Solomon, and the others, glory and honor, by obeying them, calling them Lord, and even bowing before them, and even becoming prostrate before them at times. By extension, they were actually glorifying God who made them kings. Now, mind you, if you talked about, well, we want you to bow down to this idol, this false idol or something, no dice. If you were to bow down and worship in that sense, nothing. If you bowed down and worshiped these kings as though they were God, that would be a horrible error. But to worship, honor, and give glory to God's kings is what God wanted. It's what he desired. And if you'd have been back there, then you'd have seen people bowing to David, going down and calling him Lord. And you'd say, get up, you're making David God. Well, no, you're not. You're just doing what God wanted you to do. So with Solomon, look here, this person's come in here and they're going clear down and bowed their whole body down before him. But that's awful. No, you're just doing what God wanted you to do for his kings, his leaders, for those he has given glory. So they, by extension, God is pleased that they were glorifying the God who made them kings. Okay, and so it is with Jesus and God. And when we talk about kings, Jesus is like God's greatest king, but he's still one God has made king. Yeah, but he's still greater than any that went before. And there will never be another after him of this station. So many kings then give deference, honor, to this greatest king. So in fact, in Revelation, we find Jesus being referred to as the King of Kings. Wow, that's a king over other kings. That's tremendous. And so I think it's amazing to me to read what it's saying. They will make war on the Lamb, so these enemies will come against the Lamb. And the Lamb, this is beautiful, will conquer them. For he is Lord of lords and King of kings. And those with him are called and chosen and faithful. Aha! I think that's us. I want to be on that part about being called and chosen and faithful. I think that's tremendous. So Jesus is, wow, you know, I guess Solomon was great. I don't know if you'd have called him Lord over other lords or not. I guess he was. There were other lords in Israel and men of high station and all that might have been called Lord. But he was Lord over them. And other kings, I don't know. He was certainly the king of the land. But I'm going to tell you right now, in the resurrection, all those leaders, kings, lords who will be there, they will see Jesus as the Lord of all lords and the King of all kings for eternity, because that's God's choice. So here we see that he's Lord of lords and King of kings, and so those who are making war with the Lamb will not prevail, because God is with him. And guess what? He wasn't these things innately within himself. God made him these things. You know, God gave these things to him. Just as God made Solomon great and gave him great glory, he has made Jesus great, and even greater glory belongs to him. And other lords and other kings will be subject to him, even for eternity. And you can establish that for yourself, I think, just by again visiting our wonderful scripture in Psalm 110 and 1. David, remember, in the resurrection and eternally will be subject to Jesus the Messiah, the Christ, his own descendant. That's an amazing thing. In spirit, David calls the Messiah Lord, which is interesting. Here's David, the progenitor of all the kings, we would say, the lineage of kings in Israel, and yet David is calling somebody else his Lord. And Psalm 110 and 1, we find it. It's in spirit that he says this. That means in under the influence of the Spirit, not just normal everyday stuff. Okay. But he says, Yahweh, the Lord, says to my Lord. Okay. That second Lord is actually the Messiah. We can establish it. We don't have to wonder about it. You know, Peter lets us know that in Acts 2 on the day of Pentecost, and it's otherwise found in the New Testament. So look it up, kind of study that through, and there's no question about it. The Lord, the Messiah, is David's Lord, but he wasn't back there. He's David's Lord in eternity, in the resurrection. And David himself will bow to this Lord. Isn't that amazing? It's a great mystery indeed that King David, father of the kings, himself would bow to this one, but he will. And I think that's tremendous. So the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. So in reality, the power, the work that causes Jesus's enemies to be made his footstool, that actually is originating and coming from God himself. It's not innately in Jesus. Now, he will go forth and do wonderful things, but it's because God's empowering him. He will be Lord of lords because God has made him that. He will be King of kings because God is making him that. That's tremendous, I think. So I think then we see this, and I love this. This is one of my very favorite passages in the Bible, and Philippians 2, and entire writings have been done on this, and I've written on it myself. Some of the others of you have, I know. But listen to this, because here's where we get the accurate, proper picture of Jesus in relationship to God, and Jesus being glorified, and Jesus being honored, worshiped, glorified. Okay. So in Philippians 2, verse 9, therefore, because Jesus humbled himself, and even to death on the cross, therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name. That was not innately his. He didn't come up with that. God gave him this name that's above every name, which is really a reference to his station, not just the word name that he was known by, but it's his station, his place above everyone else. So God exalted him, gave him that name above every name. Verse 10, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Not that Jesus Christ is God, but Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Look at all that's packed into this. It's just amazing to me. So God has exalted him. Otherwise, he wasn't exalted. If God hadn't exalted him, would he have been exalted anyway? I don't think so. God gave him the name that's above every name. If God hadn't given him that name, would he have had it? I don't think so. It's the will of God then that at the name of Jesus, perhaps the announcement of his name, every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. And by the way, that doesn't end. In the kingdom of God, every knee will bow to Jesus Christ forever because he is God's ultimate king. He is God's greatest leader. He is the one that God is above all vesting to be the leader and ruler of his people forever. That's the reason that David is able to say in spirit, the Lord said to my Lord. David has a Lord, not back then, but he has a Lord that in spirit he's able to see and realize in the kingdom of God, David will bow his knee to this one that God has made Lord over all. So, and not only David, but if Solomon's there, Solomon will bow his knees. Then you'll be able to remember, hey, I remember when Dan was talking about this, where he said that Jesus would be Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Wow, so in the kingdom, when you see David and Solomon bowing their knees before Jesus, just remember this night. I think this is great. It's really tremendous. Every knee should bow. Guess what? That includes everybody else. The progenitors, those who preceded Jesus, they will bow to him. He didn't say some knees won't. He said every knee will bow. I mean, I believe with all of my heart. That includes Moses. Jesus won't bow to Moses. Moses will bow to Jesus. Moses did not save the human race and redeem creation. Jesus is accomplishing that. Jesus is doing that. So every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess, every tongue should confess that Jesus, Messiah, is Lord. And what does this do? This brings glory and pleasure to God the Father. If you think God was happy because people were honoring Solomon or David, well, that was really just a beginning point. God is very pleased that we would honor this one whom he has made Lord and he's made Christ. I think that's tremendous. So, wow. Let's come back to us for a minute then and think about our situation. Our praise and our worship is, scripturally speaking, it's a sacrifice to God. Hebrews 13:15. It's talking about Jesus, and it says, through him, that is Jesus, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God. Okay, Jesus is involved in that. It's because of him we can do this. And it's because he's our mediator that we can actually come to God for ourselves. That's tremendous. And so continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips that give thanks to his name. But here's what I'm saying. Our worship, our praise, we should make sure it is an acceptable sacrifice. A sacrifice in truth. Remember Jesus told the dear lady at the well in John the 4th chapter that, you know, the day is coming when those are the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, not confusion. Wow. So let us have a sacrifice then of worship and praise that is pleasing to God and pleasing to Christ. So Peter said this in 1 Peter 2 and 5. He said, let yourselves, plural, be built into a spiritual house together, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. And again, through Jesus Christ. We're not going around Jesus. We're coming to God because of him, through him, if you will. And God receives us because of that. So let me clarify then, because I think sometimes people don't understand this. When we are striving, and we do, for people to understand the true identities of God and of Jesus, it's not a technical issue. And every time I talk to people and say, oh yeah, that's nice, that's really good, and I believe that, I don't think those people many times have got it yet. They don't understand. It's not a technical issue. These are matters of first priority. You're going to serve God, then what God are you serving? Are you going to serve him in confusion? If you're going to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, then who are you serving? How does this work? Are you confusing him and God to the point that your whole worship is in confusion? Is some of it in vain? I don't know. But these are matters of first priority. We're striving then. The striving is for them, for God, that we would honor him wonderfully, truly, spirit and truth. And for Christ, that he would be honored for who he is, spirit and truth. And the worshipers themselves, so that we can have, they can have clarity in their faith, clarity in their worship, and so that nothing is between us and God. So when you hear a message, a lesson, a teaching about who God is, don't say, well, I've heard that. No, say, I want to hear more about that, because that's probably the greatest underlying theme in the entire Bible. It really is. Remember, in the beginning, God, that starts our Bible. We need to know who he is before we go to worshiping in vain or in confusion. And when you hear someone talking or teaching a lesson about who Christ really is, don't say, well, I understand that. I've known that for years. And no, get into it. He is an object of our worship, the object of our worship. But to worship him in confusion is awful. Confusing him with God, confusing with him and giving him the honor for being the creator in Genesis, this is utter confusion. Let's get clarity in our worship. Let's get clarity in our praise. And let's glorify God and Jesus for who they really are. I think, otherwise, how can we really be pleasing God? So then I'll say this again. It's not our problem. Worshiping Jesus, that's not a problem for us. We who believe that he is the true human Son of God. Everything we're saying about Jesus works, and we can worship him if we do so appropriately. We do, I think. We worship him according to Acts 2:36. We preach that. Just know this, that God has made that same Jesus you crucified both Lord and Christ. God made him that. We worship him as the one God made Lord, the one God made Christ, not the one who was innately already those things. How do you make somebody something they already are? Makes no sense. We don't worship him as being God, but we worship him as God's Messiah, his greatest king. Would you bow before him? Every knee will bow. Bow. Would you call him Lord? Everybody's going to call him Lord before this is over. Why? Because he's already those things innately? No, because God has given these things to him. And ultimately, it's to the glory and honor of the God whose plan and work this is. What do you think? Jesus bowed his knees to his Father. We bow our knees before his Father and before Jesus as his Christ. So the serious problem then is to those who worship Jesus as being God, coming all the way back to my original question. That is confusion. It's entirely unacceptable. We have to help people to get past that. And the question, again, I have to ask, and I don't know the answer to it. Might God count that as idolatry? Because you're worshiping somebody who's being God Almighty, and they're not. So, wow, if that's the case, might it be idolatry in the eyes of God? If so, will he forgive us for it? I don't know. You know, again, as my friend Joel Hemphill said, I'm in sales, not in management. God will decide these things. But do you really want to go to the day of judgment and say, oh, Father, yeah, I was worshiping Jesus because I thought he was you? Well, that's really great, isn't it? I don't want to be there on the day of judgment in that situation. I don't want to have lived my life thinking such things. There's a better way. So think about these things. We're about great things, and all these things tie together. They all work together. Worship is not its own separate issue. When you're talking about who God is, you're talking about clarity for worship. When you're talking about who Jesus really is, you're talking about clarity for worship and how that's going to be working in your faith and working in your life. So we have something very sure to work with here. We have something that God has given to us. We are honored to be able to worship God. We should take greatest of care that we're worshiping Him for who He is and no one else for who God is. And we should take great care that we're worshiping Jesus for who He is. And don't worship anybody else as being Him. But to worship God as though He were Jesus, or worship Jesus as though He is God, that's got to stop. It's just wrong. And that's all I have to say about that. There you go. Thank you.